name is Linda Farr, and welcome to Animal Adventures. Today, Animal Adventures is taking you to Seacoast Science Center for BioBlitz! BioBlitz is a day to take and record what you get to see in nature. And we will be talking to Wendy Lull, the director of Seacoast Science Center, to learn all about Seacoast Science Center. And we also, there'll be specialists such as for ponds, mammals, seaweed, and much more. So join me for Animal Adventures at the Seacoast Science Center for BioBlitz. Hi, I'm here with Wendy Lull, president of the Seacoast Science Center. So Wendy, can you explain to me, let's start with the Seacoast Science Center.
Oh, sure.
So explain about the Seacoast Science Center, what the Science Center is.
And what we do.
Yes.
Okay, well, we are a nonprofit marine science education institution, and ocean education is what we do.
Explain BioBlitz and the importance of BioBlitz.
Sure. So we are in our 11th year at BioBlitz. It's an international effort that was started by a famous biologist named D.O. Wilson out of Harvard, who's trying to help build people's appreciation and awareness, is just saying, about all the diversity of life that's around us.
What is the importance of algae to the ecosystem, and why is it important to keep track of what algae is in the water?
A source of oxygen to the entire world. Algae, like plants, produce oxygen from the waste products that they take in. So algae actually produce, I think, as much oxygen as rainforests. So we need to have a good supply of algae at all levels in the sea.
Join us for our 11th annual BioBlitz. Thank you so much. Today is also International Coastal Cleanup Day, so if you wanted to, after your BioBlitz of the plants, pick up some data cards and help us clean up the park, we would really appreciate it. Today we're going to have the plant walk is going to be led by Danielle, Henry, and Ben will do kind of crowd control and support, okay? They'll be out for about an hour. You can stay with them the whole time, or you can just kind of trail off. We just ask that the kids stay with their caretakers. So you guys are going to explore the park. Our goal today is to find as many species as we can. We know that there are 2,015 species that can exist here. We've never really been able to find more than about 900 in a given day. So we're trying to find as many species as we can. And please, please, please do not ignore the obvious, like an oak tree. We actually need to get those on the list. Humans, we need to get on the list. Actually, sometimes it means that people are so focused on getting the unusual species that we miss out on all the common species. So your little list here are the 100 most likely species you are to find in the state park. Don't assume that we don't have those checked off on our official list. Those really do help us out.
Some of the things that can be overlooked. This little, I like to show that my campers this little plant. It looks a lot like chamomile. It's related to chamomile, the tea that you drink. It doesn't have the flat, the rays. But if you crush it, and you'll find it all around in here, everybody should find a little bit right there. Crush it between your fingers. Don't worry about it. We won't eradicate it. Okay, common name is pineapple weed. It's got a really nice pineapple smell to it. And so you could make a tea out of that as well, like you do chamomile.
Pinch it.
Pineapple.
It actually does smell like pineapple. As we walk along, we may see and identify some as people would call weeds. But all plants are important.
Those are ghosts.
Even weeds.
You want to show them that?
Here. These are nice wild roses. Those look really beautiful when bloomed. They also smell really nice. They have some thorns on it, so be careful. But if you want to take a closer look.
So Rosa rugosa. Rugosa means wrinkled. In Latin. So if you look at the leaves, you see the leaves are wrinkled. People also call it seaside or sea spray rose. Got really big rose hips, really high in vitamin C.
Oh, you can eat it, yeah.
Came from Asia, and now it spreads.
See them all
over
the Cape.
Yeah, you can certainly eat it. Go ahead, Daniel.
This is the wild rose. Wow. You see it all over the Cape, along the coast.
Yeah, all sorts. Just be careful. There's a little thorn.
Yeah, there's a little thorn, if you're careful.
Sound like you're going to say something good there.
During the Second World War, when fruits were hard to get in England, people would pick these hips for rose hip syrup, which gave the children a dose of vitamin C that they couldn't have because we didn't have oranges and other fruits. So we got vitamin C through our rose hip syrup.
What you can do is, you don't want to eat the whole thing because it's full of seeds, but I like to pretend like a little rabbit, and you just use your incisors. And you can eat the outside skin, and it's nice and sweet, and very high in vitamin C. And my wife makes rose hip jam with it.
Rose hip jam?
The skin on the outside is very sweet. It's good, but there's plenty of seeds on the inside.
So, you actually made the tea from the berry here?
From the hip.
From the hip?
Yeah.
What's the hip?
The hip is the berry, you're right. That's the fruit.
Okay.
It's the fruit, and basically, they dry the outer part and make a tea out of it.
So this is... the black cherry.
It's the. Could you get everybody around you?
Sorry.
Otherwise, we can't hear you.
Yep.
Got some black cherry trees.
Yep, that's what we're looking at. Yeah. This is a nice example of black cherry here. And if you look at the bark, my teacher explained it. It looks like black kind of potato chips, kind of curling up here.
Yeah.
So isn't it kind of cool?
Can you break it off?
Yeah, you can break it off.
So this black cherry, can you eat the black cherries off of this?
No, I'm not sure on that.
Whoa! Jack, look!
Yeah.
Now, like, as far as the shape of the leaf, how else can you identify the cherry?
So I usually either go by the shape of the leaf or by the bark tends to be good. You can also ID trees by the buds on them. I don't think we have a good example up close.
I don't see any black knot.
Yeah, no.
So how would you describe the shape of these leaves to identify the black cherry? They're still like long, elongated, like?
Yeah, elongated, single leaves, not compound.
In other words, it's all like
very smooth on the edge.
Serrated. So you take a leaf like that, and you go look at some before.
Yeah.
I'd say they
are biennials. They'll just put up leaves. Basil leaves the first year, and then the second year they'll put up the flowering stalk, and then they die. It's biannual, 2 years. First year, just the leaves. Queen Anne's lace is the same. Second year, we'll put up the flower. There's a morning glory right there.
So what would be an annual plant? So like an example of an annual?
Annual plant just goes to seed in 1 year, and then dies, and then it will, the way it goes on is through the seed.
So plants that have bulbs that come out, so, or plants that come year after
perennial.
Year after year, and those are called perennials.
Perennial.
So you have perennials that come out year after year after year.
And what's this?
Biannuals that flower only every other year.
Right.
And then you have
annual is 1 year. Yep. Here and here. You can see here it's gone to seed. That's the, you'll see that all through, it'll turn brown and that will persist through the winter. Those seed heads.
You're the bird.
And there's some burdock. Yep, you can see where the leaves. That's the
tree here is still black cherry, but it doesn't have the potato chip effect. It's younger. But if you look at the leaves, you realize it's the same species that you're looking at. So as it ages, the texture of the bark kind of changes over time.
Invasive plant in the park is Oriental bittersweet.
Oh yeah.
Okay, right here. And it's a vine, and it's coating everything. People, like the berries in arrangements, and that's kind of how it spreads as well.
The birds like it.
And the birds.
Kills all the trees.
So there's the sow thistle or sow thistle. These guys.
Yeah. Are they prickly?
And how do you identify a thistle? What categorizes a thistle?
Well, they're prickly for the most part. And there's a lot of different thistles. Thistle is actually the national flower of Scotland. People call it a weed, but they take offense to that if you call thistle a weed. But it's in the composite family, which is probably the most numerous plant family there is. But when people think of thistle, they generally think of the thorns. Yep. But there's a lot of different types of thistle. Some of them have milky sap, such as this one. You can see the white.
Right.
So the way the thistle multiplies is you see this white fuzzy stuff?
Yeah, these by the wind, these are those are the seeds.
Yeah, so these are the seeds, so then it carries in the wind. Whoop!
The trembling aspen. And what's really cool about it is the petiole on this leaf, which is where the leaf connects to the branch, is flat. So it makes it flutter in the breeze, and it's a cooling mechanism so that the leaves lose less water when the stomata on the leaves are open during the day.
See how the wind's blowing now?
So yeah, and they kind of tremble in the breeze.
It kind of tips the hot air off it, as it were. Yeah. Yes.
This is the shagbark hickory.
So the leaves are compound leaves, meaning they're made up of several leaflets. If you look closely.
Oh, sure.
How many leaflets does it have?
Three? Well,
a little more.
Oh, one, two, three, four, five.
About five.
Yep.
Five big leaflets on the shagbark. And this isn't very shaggy. As they get bigger and older, they get
more shaggy. We should see hopefully some good examples of that as we go. But the giant, almost dinner plate size leaves, I think, are nice to see. See the nuts around on the ground. Chipmunks and squirrels love these, and they're all over.
If you look closely at this tree here, you'll notice these. If you look real close, there's holes in it. Horizontal lines of holes. Yeah. Any guesses on that?
Woodpecker!
The yellow-bellied sapsucker made those holes. It's that type of woodpecker. You see those horizontal holes? It has to be the yellow-bellied sapsucker.
And what's he digging for? Is it actually sap or is it?
Sap and the bugs that come to the sap.
Programs, and we're going to spend a little time today just walking around and trying to find whatever signs we can find that mammals were here. And before we get started on a mammal walk, can anybody give me a definition of a mammal? What is a mammal? Yes. Wonderful. It's a warm-blooded animal.
Yep.
Excellent. And what else? It has fur on it. Beautiful. Is there anything else that mammals have or do? Anybody know? How do mammals feed their babies? Yeah.
They don't lay eggs.
They don't lay eggs.
Correct.
It's true except for one, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Excellent. Two. And how do they feed their babies? I thought I saw another hand.
How do they feed their babies?
Yeah.
Do they use
Not sure. What do they make for their babies? Very good. They make milk. Beautiful. So our goal is to try to find all the mammals that are living with us here on this land, and it's more than you think. It's pretty easy to walk through the woods here and look around and be like, what, there's no mammals here? I saw was a gray squirrel. That's all there is around here. But I guarantee you, every time you take a walk at Odeorn, do you know what's watching you? Mammals. And they're there. They're out there. They're just very good at hiding and being in places where you can't see them. So today we're going to try to learn a little bit about how to read the woods and how to know when they've been here.
You know, I may like deer, but I also like bobcats, coyotes. There are so many wonderful mammals here in New England. It's really hard for me to pick a favorite.
One of the things I'm most passionate about is going outside and finding tracks. A great tip on kind of maybe thinking more like an animal is to see like an animal. So if you find a run and you feel so inclined, lay down in front of it and get yourself on eye level with it. It totally changes your perspective of it. So it's easier for me to put myself in the mind of that animal when I'm on its level. So cottontail run, feel free to lay down on your belly if you want to, and we'll find a few more as we move out.
You know, what exactly are you looking for? You're looking for the depressions in the woods where something has moved through? Is
yeah,
that what you're
and
really
I'm also looking for, it's tricky because it's an area where the place is groomed, but I'm also looking for small shrubs kind of broken off, and yeah, particularly that 45 degree angle.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, to indicate it might be feeding.
Oh, okay. So small shrubs broken off.
Some really nice vole tunnels going from the mowed grass into the thicker stuff. You can see them there as we pass by. Lots of vole tunnels going all through the grass here. It looks like a burrow that's kind of what's the word I'm looking for? Taking advantage of the situation, right? So definitely an animal has been burrowing where the roots kind of naturally started to lift up. It's really big at the entrance, so looking at it from this direction, I might get really excited and think, oh, that's a fox. But if you look inside, the rocks and roots create a narrow channel, so it's maybe an animal that not much bigger around than that.
Raccoon!
Groundhog?
Groundhog looks like a groundhog burrow to me.
Woohoo, yay!
Yeah. I would challenge, Mark Elbrock is an author of some really good guidebooks on tracking, and a challenge he used to give himself is to sit down anywhere at any time and not move until he found a hare. So I have a feeling that with a little bit of effort, somebody could find some hares in the burrow, maybe attached to some of the roots that are sticking up as the groundhog came in or out. So that'd be a fun challenge to find a hare.
Also, they usually have more than one entrance.
Here you can see like a spider web. People say, oh, spiders! But spiders are very important to actually the control of insects. And you can see like an insect like right here. And then you can see the web right here. You can see how back here.
Okay, come on.
See, he could have gone way back in there. Hi! We are at the Seacoast Science Center, and we're at one of their ponds. As you can see, there's lots of people here helping to collect animals to see how healthy the pond is. Here we have the pumpkin seed right here. I'm trying to get one in my hand here a little bit, but keep them in the water. Here's a little pumpkin seed that I have in my hand here. Here's a catfish right here. And what do the catfish, what is their bobbles used for? Is their bobbles used to find food?
Yeah, they're very sensory.
And then what do they eat?
They'll eat anything they can fit in their mouth, anything from small fish to worms, insects.
How much do those grow?
Probably a couple of pounds, two, three pounds.
Do they get that really big that you see in the, you know, where they're pulling them out of the rock and everything and rolling them?
No,
those yeah, are they
yeah,
have.
Doing. Yeah, right, right.
They no? have catfish that you think are like in the Mississippi River, yeah. And those things are.
Because they look
huge.
Exactly like them.
Those are smaller birds. Those are channel cats. I think those are flatheads.
Oh, flatheads.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's the dragonfly larva.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Those guys are quite the predator when they're underwater and when they're flying around, too.
Really, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell what and dragonflies are important for mosquito control.
But that's going to grow up to be a dragonfly.
Do you know what kind of dragonfly?
They live in the pond.
Oh, I'm not sure. There's so many
what they do?
Species.
They eat mosquito
larvae. Yeah, it'd be helpful to have a key. You can kind of identify it by the number of spines.
The look of their
gills
and
so that's a dragonfly larvae. So then, would they, so to speak, they would stay like that until the spring? Because like we're going into the fall, into the winter, so you don't actually, so you wouldn't really see dragonflies. So what would happen to this larvae?
I'm not positive, but I would assume that it would stay in the water and stay in this
stage. Yeah, but what I'm saying, I think it is it in the spring that it would metamorphosize into a dragonfly?
I wouldn't quote me, but that's what I would assume.
Oh, okay.
Probably in the summer.
I believe they live in the water for 2 years and then transform into flying creatures.
So they're typically in ponds, lakes, and slow-moving streams, or lakes, or rivers, I mean, but...
Yeah.
Yep. So that one's probably going to be another year. Some of them can suck in water into their abdomen and jet it out and move pretty quick. And they're... Oh.
What'd you find?
Is that a damselfly that's on top of it? Yep, there's a damselfly that's hanging out, a really tiny one. See that one swimming in there?
Oh yeah, here it goes. If I can see with your finger, so here's a damselfly. So they have this larvae form, and then what happens is they will actually transform themselves into what you see flying around during the summertime. Here are the bullfrog tadpoles.
That's what we're thinking.
I think they're getting done the frogs.
Yep.
We're going to take them back and we'll more
look what he's got.
Securely identify. Very nice.
Nice.
What is big?
Very nice.
Yeah, because they call catfish hornpole. Oh, is this cool? Is captured in currents. Along the east coast of the United States, there is what they call the Gulf Stream Current. The Gulf Stream Current can all go all the way up to Maine. What happens is juvenile fish are not really strong enough, the juvenile fish down in the Caribbean, and that's where the Gulf Stream Current goes, are not strong enough to be able to go against the current. So if they get actually into the Gulf Stream Current, they can actually go all the way up even to Massachusetts, such and say Rhode Island. So if you were like in Newport, Rhode Island, you can maybe actually see juvenile fish from the Caribbean. And places like the New England Aquarium sometimes get their juvenile fish that you would find in the Caribbean actually off the coast of Rhode Island. have had so much fun at Seacoast Science Center, BioBlitz. I learned so much about mammals, seaweed, plants. It was wonderful. And so, I would like to thank you so much for watching Animal Adventures. And until the next time, have your own animal adventures. You can even go to Seacoast Science Center and have yourself a wonderful time, just like I did.